talk about the research that I've been doing on the recruitment of migrant labour to Qatar in particular. And I think that you'll see many issues there because we are talking about a Muslim... Are we talking about a Muslim-majority country or not? We will need to maybe think about that. So I want to start off with a bit of background, and it's about the actual recruitment of mainly Asian migrant workers to Qatar. Let me begin by just giving you a few statistics, if you don't mind. The Middle East and the Gulf region really is huge with regard to migrant flows. It's probably the largest migrant flow region in the world today, or certainly one of them. That is primarily since the mid-1970s with the oil price boom and the incredible wealth that flowed into the Gulf states, the GCC states. So there you see some figures, but what's interesting about Qatar in particular, although it's very, very similar in many ways, but Qatar is really a unique country from the point of view that it has the lowest proportion of nationals in its population than any country in the world, right? So you can see that nationals, this is 2013 figures, was only 9.6% of the total population. And as migrant workers in greater numbers come into the country, that even reduces further the proportion or the ratio of the nationals to non-nationals in the country. And indeed, it's even more stark when you actually look at the workforce itself. Nationals comprise only 6% of the workforce. And Qatari males, only 4% of the total male workforce, and only 1% are working in the private sector. So in other words, most of Qatari nationals work in the public sector, right, where there are great privileges given to them in working in the public sector. The main industry sector, as you can see very clearly, that construction is the largest industry that employs people, 37%. And you can see public administration and defense, 51% are Qatari nationals employed in the public sector. Now, Qatar, as well as all the GCC countries, do not provide official statistics on the nationalities of the population and the workforce. The statistics that they provide is only Qataris and non-Qataris, nationals and non-nationals. They do not break it up into particular. But from a survey that was done on low-income migrant workers, we can see actually a proportion. That was a good study in that it was a proper random sample was taken so that we can generalize to the whole population. So Nepalese are the highest number in the low-skilled, low-income brackets in the country, in the workforce. But Indians are clearly the largest proportion in the workforce as a whole. Okay. So these are the main countries of origin. Now, you all know that the 2022 World Cup, Soccer World Cup, is to be held in Qatar. Well, is it? We now have the resignation of Sepp Blatter from FIFA, and it's interesting because we have seen for many years now calls for the World Cup to be withdrawn from Qatar. And that's an interesting situation because, as one person put it, if you you have a series of reforms that are actually being implemented in Qatar. Well, I'm going to talk about that because of the criticism. And if you take the World Cup away, why would you do that? Because these reforms are being taken place through the motivation of the critiques that are being presented because of the World Cup. And that's an interesting debate. And daily newspaper articles, tremendous opposition to Qatar because of the charges of bribery in getting the World Cup, but also the conditions of migrant workers in that country and in the GCC as a whole. Okay, so there have been all kinds of reports on Qatar, and I'll just give you a few of them. Like this one was the International Labour Organization, which the country has worked actually very closely with. Amnesty International report. This is Human Rights Watch. That's another one, but that was on UAE. The Supreme Committee for the World Cup actually commissioned a legal firm called DLA Piper that came up with the same kinds of analysis and recommendations. This is the report that I wrote on the recruitment process. And also a lot of public demonstrations against Qatar. This was one that was taken in Melbourne at the Melbourne Cricket Ground in one of the semi-finals of the World Cricket Cup, where this Asian woman put up this banner. And of course, all the television cameras and photographers immediately took the photo. It was taken down within minutes, by the way, but it went viral. So that these things have a big impact around the world. And here we see this word slavery being used. It is being used for many, many years now, that it's called modern day slavery, right? And the modern day slavery are the conditions under which these migrant workers are living, particularly in the Gulf. Mind you, what the analysis that I'm going to show you, it is actually not just in the Gulf, but it's actually happening all around the world, okay? The same kind of recruitment practices, the same kind of exploitation is around the world. And it's in Britain, it's in Europe, it's in the United States, and there's plenty of evidence for it, okay? So let's begin with this idea of the kafala system that is operating in Qatar and in all the GCC states. Its origins, it is argued, were Bedouin origins, protecting strangers, the idea of a guarantee, as in a commercial or a business transaction, or to take care of. That is, I've likened it to the idea of the fiduciary. If you, any of you know this concept from the British law of trust. It's the idea of a relationship it's a relationship of power, actually, like the relationship between a doctor and a patient, between a parent and a child, between a lawyer and a client, that is, you have to trust that person will look after your interests, right? Now, a kafil isn't quite like that, but it's similar. But it is an unequal power relationship, right? Just as in the fiduciary. But today it is argued that the kafala is a system of control and management over the large foreign population who are there to work and to conduct business. For example, all foreign employees must be sponsored by a Qatari citizen or a company who must also be an employer, the employer, right? The kafil must also be the employer of the foreigner. And all foreign businesses that want to do business in the country also have to have a Qatari partner who must have a 51% controlling interest in that business. And the Qatari sponsor or kafil controls the entry, allows that person to come in and that they are sponsoring them. In two countries, they also have control over the exit. In Saudi Arabia and Qatar, foreigners require an exit visa. I am in that position. I require to get an exit visa to be able to come here. Through the good grace of my director, Dr. Tarek, you see, he has to approve that I can leave the country. I'm very grateful to you.
I love it.
See this? See how power corrupts. You see. right. So. Now, from the work of a friend of mine, Mohammed Dito, who is a Bahraini, he also argues that the kafala system historically also cements the relationship between the state in the Gulf states and its citizens, right, its nationals. That in a way, with so many people being brought in to the country to develop the country with the wealth that they have been able to amass, the state actually lacked the capacity to admit to manage all of these foreigners in the country. So the kafala system was convenient in placing it in private hands, that is, in the hands of private citizens who would deal with the responsibility and the authority, okay, to bring in these people and to take care of them and to manage them. So in this sense, both the state and the citizens control foreigners in the country. But it also means that it is a means of the wealth distribution. The wealth that is being created through the oil and gas and so on can be distributed to its citizens through this means and through public employment and all the privileges of high income. Qatar has the highest GDP in the world today, right? That gives them education rights and so on and so forth. And it also means that it is a clear demarcation line between citizens and non-citizens, where the non-citizens are basically excluded from this wealth and this wealth distribution. But it also minimizes the competition between its own citizens, right? So that if I refuse to allow my employees to go and work for another company, which I can do as a sponsor or kafil, and which is done all the time, then I don't have to worry about my neighbor or my cousin taking workers from me, right? This plays out as the idea of minimizing the competition between citizens over in economic and business activities. And it also prevents a local labor market. People cannot just go and work for somebody else in the country. They need permission to do so, right? They cannot leave their current employer without permission of their employer to either leave the country or to be employed by somebody else in the country. If it's getting complicated, if you want to raise issues, if you're not understanding what I'm saying, feel free. So it prevents a local labor market. There is no local labor market, no legal labor market in these countries. There is indeed a black market that operates with irregular workers, but that's another story. Now, what I want to do here is talk about, I want to take the story with regard to the recruitment of migrant labor back to its origins. That is, where does the demand for labor begin? And it begins when there is something that needs to be done that requires workers to do it, right? And that is the tendering of projects, construction projects, building a stadium, right? Once there is a project to be done, the government basically calls for tenders. That is, if it's the Supreme Committee for the World Cup, for example, it wants to build the stadium. It has an architect that draws up the design, but then it needs people to actually build it. So it then sends out tenders, and companies, construction companies, will all bid for that project. And there is a set of procedures by which they do that, they bid for the project, okay? That procedure, I'm sorry, this is a bit, it looks a bit messy, but I'll try to. So you have people bidding for the project. The bidding process or the tendering process has two stages or two phases. The first one is what they call the technical phase, where they will evaluate all the companies who want to do this project, whether they have the technical capacity to do it, right, which is pretty crucial. So you have a lot of engineers and architects and designers and so on, all providing the specifications for the project, right? Now that's at the pre-qualification. If they qualify, that is, they comply with all the technical means by which they're going to do the project, then they go to the next phase, which is a completely separate phase. There are two envelopes that a company submits. One envelope is just all the technical issues, and the second envelope, which is not opened until the commercial phase or the commercial evaluation starts. The commercial evaluation is all the money, right? How much is it going to cost? So we want to know, we know that you can do the job. Now we want to know how much you're going to do it for. And of course, I'm going to want them to do it for the cheapest possible, right? And the most efficient. Now, this is what happens. They look at the people who have the lowest cost, all technically okay, and then they will say, okay, this is the cheapest price, so we will award the tender to that company. Now, this is where I believe that there's a tremendous problem here. But the World Bank protocols on tendering says that you should take the lowest price. And so they always justify taking the lowest bidder and giving them the contract based upon World Bank standards. And I'm going to argue that that's problematic, and I'm going to show you why. Once they've given the job to a particular company, then they say, you got the job, but look, we want you to take off another 10%. Right? So they bargain hard. What does that do? Well, it means that the contractor, who's now been squeezed for that, you know, they've given the best price they can to make a small profit, and then now they're told to take off another 10%. So what they do is the contractor is going to have subcontractors. They're going to have a whole range of other people who are going to come in to do all the various special elements of the whole project. And then those subcontractors are going to have their subcontractors. So there are going to be subcontractors. And this is where the problems really begin. Because when you are squeezing other companies for the amount of money that they're going to charge you to do these jobs, they are going to find ways to try to maximize their profits while being squeezed. And this is where what happens is that the workers that they are bringing in to employ to do these jobs are going to suffer. In fact, labor is a major expenditure in these projects. Okay, so labor then gets squeezed. It gets complicated, but I hope I can elaborate later. Now, here we're dealing with an international labor market, not a local labor market. Workers from different countries are being recruited on an international labor market. What does that mean? It means that if a company goes to Bangladesh and recruits workers, and also goes to Sri Lanka and India and Nepal and the Philippines, they're going to negotiate different wages. So workers in Qatar who are working alongside each other but from different countries are getting different wage rates because they're negotiating at an end. And the countries of origin are competing with one another. Why? Because they are in the business of exporting labor. It is very, very lucrative for those countries. Why? Because the workers who are working in those countries are sending their wages back to their families in their origin countries that they've left behind. And that's crucial, and these are what we call remittances. And if you have a look at those figures, these are 2013 remittance figures, the money flowing back to those countries is the largest foreign currency earnings for those countries. It is crucial in their national accounts. And you can see Nepal is 29% of their GDP comes from workers working abroad and sending their money back home. That's why many, I mean, I don't know, you probably read recently with the earthquakes in Nepal, and companies were refusing to allow the Nepalese workers to go home and take care of their families or to see them. that was true. That actually happened. But many of them also let them go. But also many workers were told by their families not to come. Why? Because they wanted them to stay to send money. They wanted them, because many of them were not going to get paid if they went, right? So these things get played out. So we have the company, the countries competing with one another in order for these remittances. Even though the money is private money, it gets used for everyday expenses. It's very rarely invested in profit-making activities. It's for everyday expenses of their families and to educate their children. I mean, it's invested in human capital, and that's the main source, and housing and everyday food and clothing. But the collective amount of money that it brings in means that governments can raise international loans on the strength of the remittance flows of the foreign currency earnings. So it can become very political. This is in Bangladesh, the idea of the countries encouraging their nationals to leave and to go and find work elsewhere. Right? They see it as an important for the country because it reduces unemployment in the countries of origin, right? And brings in the remittances, and also skills can get developed and brought back. There are many arguments about that. This is a photo of the Bureau of Manpower, Employment and Training in Bangladesh. one of the reasons why I took that photograph was because you can see on the columns, what do you see? Western Union. Western Union in all of these countries is ever present. It's everywhere. Just behind this building, there is another building that's a part of this, and the whole wall going about 10 floors is one huge Western Union poster. And they have offices everywhere. So Western Union is very conscious in the minds of the workers when they go to the countries where they're working, and they use Western Union to send their money back. Now, Western Union is also very expensive. The World Bank has been trying to reduce what they call the transaction costs of sending the money back. And it's terrible. They are making billions and billions of dollars from this process. They should be using hawala. But, you know, also, I noticed that in Qatar recently, the Urdu telephone company has a new provision to use MoneyGram offices all around the world, and they charge a fraction of what Western Union charge. So that's another battle. And you can see here, this is a poster from part of that Western Union poster, this idea of sending money around the globe. It is a huge, huge industry. Now, in Qatar, although there is a law, the sponsorship law in Qatar forbids employers holding the passports of workers, it is routinely done. The excuse is given that, you know, the workers like it because we keep it for safety. Right? But we know that many workers also don't like it because if a problem arises, they have their passport. But in a way, for Qatar at least, the withholding of the passports is not as big an issue, in my view, because you still need an exit visa. What's the point of having your passport if the sponsor does not give you an exit visa? Right? So there are two elements to this. And that's so the exit visa can be denied. NOC stands for Non-Objection Certificate. It means that if you want to go and work for another company, your employer has to sign a letter, a certificate, saying that it's okay for you to go and work for another employer. These are not routinely given, but some companies do give them. Now, those elements, the pass withholding of the passport, stopping people from leaving whenever they want to, and not being able to get jobs, to get another employer when they want to, is a breach of the freedom of movement under the Declaration of Human Rights. And Kamali says in his book, Citizenship, that he says, although slavery has disappeared, when a government ordains that its people may not leave their country without some special exit visa given as an act of grace, that government is, in effect, restricting the freedom of an entire people within the boundaries of its territory. And I like that statement. It's very true. Oh, no. That's it. Now, here's where we come to one of the things that I feel very strongly about. Now, what happens... let's go back, if you can remember, the part of the tendering process when the subcontractors are going to squeeze workers. It's come to being over decades now that when the companies want to reduce their costs in doing the work in these projects, there's a lot of competition between the countries and also private recruitment agencies. There are thousands and thousands of them. And they want the business, right? They want the contracts to supply the workers from these countries. So it came to be that they would say, look, we will supply you, you give us the contract to supply the workers, and you won't have to pay anything, any charges, and the costs of recruitment. You won't even have to pay our commission. Sounds like a good deal. Okay, we'll give you the contract. So companies started not paying the recruitment costs to bring in the workers to do the work. That became competitive, and the recruitment agencies began to say, look, not only will it not cost you anything, but we'll pay you. Right? And so you have a situation where does the recruitment agency get the money to pay to get the contract from the workers? So you have the situation where workers to get the job are paying a lot of money, right? Between 400 and 3,000, actually a lot more, 5,000, even up to 10,000, 15,000 for some skilled workers are paying to get these jobs, right? Now, what does that do? Also, they're having to borrow money. This is a lot of money for these very poor people from these poor countries. So they will borrow money. They sell their assets. They will sell their animals and houses and land to pay, to get enough money to get this job in the other country, in Qatar. And they're paying high interest rates. This is usury, between 30 and 60%. Right, they then have to work for months, sometimes years, before they're actually earning money for themselves to repay the loans that they have taken to get these jobs. Now, what happens, the result of this is that they are bonded, they're bound by the debt that they have incurred to get the job. So that when they arrive in the country, they can't leave. So you have a situation where I don't know if you've heard of this thing called substitute contracts. So they have a contract for a certain wage and allowances. When they arrive in the country, they're given another contract for less money. Now, when I've interviewed workers about this, I say to them, so are you receiving the wages that you were promised before you left? No. Oh. So did you tell the company when you arrived that you're getting less than what you were promised? Yes, I did. Well, what did the company say? Well, they just said, if you don't like it, you can go home. Knowing that the person, the worker, is in debt and they can't go home. They don't have the return airfare to go home. So they are bonded. It's called debt bondage. But it also means that it's forced labor because they're forced to do work for certain conditions that they did not agree to in the first place, and it conforms with the ILO's definition of forced labor. So this is a problem, and it's against labor law in Qatar, but the labor law in Qatar, where it says workers should not pay anything for recruitment fees or charges, has been interpreted as only in Qatar, so that they're paying in the country of origin that circumvents the Qatari law. But the ILO, you see down the bottom there, ILO, Convention on Private Employment Agency, says that they should not charge workers anything. And so now there is a policy. When I was working for the Qatar Foundation, I was part of the team that developed the migrant worker welfare standards for the Qatar Foundation, which was then adopted by the Supreme Committee for the World Cup. Those standards state very clearly that workers are not to pay anything, whether in Qatar or in their origin countries. But the problem is implementing these standards, because they're still doing it, right? So here we have a serious problem in beginning with the tendering to the whole money flows of this process. And what it does, it distorts the labour market. People are not being recruited, they're not being employed on the basis of their skill, on merit. They're being employed basis on the fact that they are willing and able to pay, right, for these jobs. So they might be deceived. They're told they're going to get a job for a certain amount, it's going to be terrific and wonderful, and that's not what actually happens. In fact, that deception process is human trafficking, which is actually normalized. It's not something extraordinary. It's a normal process in the recruitment industry. What I should also tell you is what also happens is that when the personnel from the project company go over to these countries to do what they call skills testing. In other words, they want to interview the person to see if they want to employ them and test if they have the skills that they want, whether it's, you know, an electrician or a mason or a steel fixer or a, you know, various occupations. When they go over there, they demand of the recruitment agency that they pay their hotel bill. Oh, we want to stay in a five-star hotel. And they pay their food. We know also that the recruitment agency sometimes might, if they want to go to a casino, do some gambling, they have to give them some money. Or for prostitution, we know that they pay for that too. And then these people, they say then to the recruitment agency, give us the receipts that you paid. And when they go back to their company, they'll actually say, oh, we paid this, and they get reimbursed. This is corruption. This corruption is occurring every day. And the people who actually choose the recruitment agency will take money from the agency in order to give them that as a bribe, to give them the contract. It was offered to me. During my research, there was an agency that I interviewed, and they thought that I was from the Qatar Foundation, and therefore the Qatar Foundation has many big projects and that I'm there to look at recruiting. So they thought that I could actually do business with them. This one particular company would just refused to accept that I was not in a position to do that and kept actually harassing me. So finally I decided to answer his calls. I was not answering his calls. So I said, okay, what's in it for me? I thought I'd test this out. So he said, well, we can't talk about this on the telephone. Let's meet for coffee. So I met him for coffee. So I said to him, so, okay, I'll give you a contract to supply me with 100 workers. He said, well, we can give you $600 per head. So if I give him a contract for 100 workers, he will give me $60,000 in my pocket, cash, with no paperwork. Where does he get the money? From the worker. So we know that one worker is paying, let's say, $400, another is paying $1,500. We know then that the worker who paid $1,500 is the one who's paying for this bribe to get the contract. Typically engineers, human resource managers, middle management are getting this money. So when we go around to the companies and talk to these people, I look at their watches. So if there's a human resource manager wearing a $5,000, $10,000 watch, I know where he got the money, right? So these are what one person in the ILO said, these are bribes for the jobs. In fact, I'm changing that. It's not a bribe, because that assumes that the worker is bribing the agency. That's not what's happening. The agency is demanding this money from the worker to give them the job. So it's extortion, right? And that's what's happening, this corruption, these kickback bribes to the employing companies, that is what is happening. I don't have enough time to give you all these other details, but I can later on if necessary. The main complaints for workers are underpayment, non-payment of their wages, and delayed payment of their wages. These are the principal complaints that are being made. And food allowances. Sometimes they're not getting the food allowance. We have actually argued that they should not be given food allowances. They should be given food. Because workers typically want to maximize their income. If they're given a food allowance, they use that food allowance as their wage. And they don't eat properly. There was one company that had 50 workers from their company in hospital because they were not eating properly. They were starving themselves to send all of that money back home to their families. So, and still, they are taking wage deductions from workers when they should not be. And I have evidence of that, by the way, too. Reform. Well, through all the pressures, the Qatar Foundation, which I was a part of, developed the mandatory standards for migrant worker welfare for all subcontractors and subcontractors. There's also the American, in the United States, they have the Foreign Corrupt Practices Act. That means that's a really interesting legislation. Any American company that's doing business in another country and using subcontractors or there's a whole supply chain. If there's any corruption of government officials, the original, any US company can be prosecuted. If that, however tenuous that connection is. And so the big corporations, the big transnational corporations, are very keen not to have that happen, and they make sure that they actually employ companies to do evaluations of their supply chain because their reputations are very, very important. The Nike Corporation had to do it, Apple Corporation had to do it, and they got into trouble. So they spend a lot of money to make sure that there's no corruption. Same with the UK Anti-Bribery Act. Recently, that happened with Carillion after a BBC report on Qatar. And there's also a European Commission. There is legislation, European legislation, on jurisdiction enforcement, which also means the same kind of thing. And there's been recently a case brought by a legal NGO in Paris against the Vinci company, big corporation in France, with a company operating in Qatar called QDVC. And so that's happening. So they do these labor supply evaluations to try and stop it. Now there's been some reform proposed by the Qatar authorities. It began last year, and they made a statement at the Human Rights Commission in Geneva that the kafala system would be reformed, that no longer would the sponsors be private sponsors of nationals, Qatari nationals, but the government would be the sponsor, and it would rely upon the contracts between employers and employees, that the wages have to be paid through a bank transfer to make sure that there is an official record of how much is being paid and when it is being paid, so that, the Qatari construction sector around the world is notorious. It has a reputation for not paying. The corporations not paying between corporations and not paying workers. Right, and this is unconscionable in Islam, that wages are not paid. I mean, the idea in the Quran, it says, that the worker should be paid before the sweat, before his sweat dries, which I think is a very eloquent principle. And the exit visas, now there will not be an exit visa required, but if you're leaving the country, you have to give 72 hours notice, and that gives enough time for an employer to raise an objection or a no, put a travel ban on a person if there is a conflict or there's some kind of problem. The NOCs, no permission from an employer will be required, but only at the end of the period of the contract. And if the contract is an indeterminate contract, it will be after 5 years. So you have to work for 5 years before you can transfer employment without permission of your employee. The UAE is the same. In Bahrain, you only have to be working for 1 year before you can transfer employers. In Qatar at the moment, if a worker is working, finishes the contract and then goes back home, cannot come back into the country and work for another employer after 2 years. So they have a ban. You can come back to the same employer, but if you want another employer, you can't do it for 2 years. They're going to change that to 6 months. We've also called for other kinds of reforms for bilateral or multilateral agreements between the countries. So between the Qatar government and all of the origin countries of workers to say, come to an agreement that workers should not have to pay for all these recruitment charges. To develop a notion of ethical recruitment based upon the law and ethical principles. That's recently happened in Nepal between the ministries, the two ministries of Qatar and the Nepal, ministries of labor, saying we're going to supply workers from Nepal, but the condition is that the workers do not pay anything. Right? Remains to be seen. Greater transparency in the tendering process so that we know what the companies who are tendering are going to be paying for and whether they're going to be paying for the recruitment charges or whether they're going to continue in this bribery process. And what's happening now is an accreditation system so that they should only work with accredited recruitment agencies, people who have a principle and a policy of not taking money from workers, that they will arrive in Qatar debt-free. It'll make a lot of difference. And increased policing of these standards by the Ministry of Labour. They've just increased their inspectorate. They're actually being trained by the Qatar Foundation right now. And to prosecute violators is very, very important. Well, I'm just going to show you now just a few photographs to give you at least some visual images of what happens in these countries of origin. This is, for example, one of the trade testing places where workers train and also where the company goes to watch how well they can do the job. So here you have a scaffolder. So they watch them to see if their skills are good enough to employ them. This is in Bangladesh at a government skills training center. And if you can't read it, I'll read you what's actually enshrined on the top there. It says, skill is one's own asset. Skilled manpower is an asset of the country. Right? So you can see the governments are very much involved in this because of the importance, the economic importance of this migration flows. This is a photograph of some Bangladeshi women who are being trained and what's called pre-departure orientation. They're about to be deployed to the Gulf as domestic workers, as migrant domestic workers. And you see at the back there, they've got a little kitchen where they also talk about cooking and you know. This is in Manila. This is a three-story building that houses women about to be deployed as domestic workers. It can hold up to 800 women waiting to be deployed. I was very fortunate they actually allowed me inside, and that's how they're inside. Bunk beds on three floors, hundreds and hundreds of young women waiting to be deployed as domestic workers. Again, in Manila, there are required training processes. The government, TESDA, is a government program for training, and this is on domestic workers in Manila. This is the woman here in the forefront is the head of the training program in this particular area. Behind that, what's it called? The barrier behind the wood panel there is this. crammed in there, and they're being trained about how to set a table and so on. Right? You see they're being trained by a man rather than a woman. And they, this is rather humorous, they rather ambitious in the the people they think they're going to be serving. Nancy Reagan, Michelle Obama, Imelda Marcos, Hillary Clinton. And they also, you can't see it, but they also have had a place there where they had Arab spices. So they've got all the particular Arab spices and going to train them how to cook Arabic food. So, this is in an area called Mabini, outside of Manila, where it's a place where many, many women and other Filipinos go from, and they go and work abroad. And they have programs for their families. For example, financial literacy, how to handle the money, don't spend it all, and so on and so forth, how to invest. They also have programs for schools for the families and other kinds of activities for the families of those whose main breadwinner is abroad, whether it be a woman doing domestic work or the man. There are positive outcomes. It's not as if things don't happen. I mean, you know, people still go back to these countries to work because they do get more money than they would earn at home if they could even get a job. And this is an area just outside of Mabini. All of those houses have been paid for and developed by the remittances that these Filipinos and Filipinas have actually sent back. And here, this is actually a very rare, FSI is an ethical recruitment agency that was developed specifically to be an ethical agency, and it does not charge workers for recruitment. They don't charge anything. And why I put this here is that they have this map in their office in Kathmandu where they show that they are the ones that do the recruitment in the regional areas. Often you have what's called these sub-agents, people in these small villages who take money, who promise them the world, and who deceive them. They don't rely upon, and they're actually operating illegally in all of these countries. So they make sure that they are the ones who are doing the direct recruitment to make sure that there's no corruption. And that's why that's there. I think that's where I leave it. I mean, these are the conventions, but as we've said, conventions seem to be pretty meaningless these days, so let's just leave it there for discussion. Yes. We need the microphone. I don't know. Oh. Okay, you tell me. I'm sorry. Okay. Right at the back. Actually, I gave the wrong overhead. I had lots of other things.
I have three quick questions, but the first one is more a clarification on the scope of your analysis. From what I can see, it only focuses on workers in a specific fields. It's not all the immigration. Okay,
that's right.
Thank you. The second one, and I don't know whether you can draw just a parallel and then explain why do we have a double standard approach on the immigration. I think you mentioned the scope of your analysis is Qatar, but I think it applies similarly to UAE and Saudi. maybe Kuwait also. So on one hand, we have the workers, and then I think you raised most of the challenges in your presentation, who sometimes are abused, have no rights, and work in very difficult conditions. And on the other hand, you have, I don't like this term because I find it itself discriminated, which is the brains migration, who enjoy all kind of privileges.
Yes.
It can go up to sometimes diplomatic status, etc. So I don't see why a worker, a Bangladeshi worker who is working in construction and there's sometimes when it's 45 degrees outside, yes, cannot enjoy the same rights. I'm talking about basic rights as British wine manager who is enjoying his air-conditioned office in the IFC while still having a beautiful view on panoramic view of Dubai. So I don't see why can they enjoy the same rights. Is this ethical? And then my second question is, what do you think about the what we're having now in what we're observing now in Qatar and UAE, which is the Qatarization, Emiratization, where for some positions we give the priority to locals, and I think you mentioned that especially in the private sector there is a lack of locals, so they rely heavily on foreigners, especially from the West and from Maghreb. So is this a fear of the excessive immigration in these areas? And we also see that they're attracting also some international universities and also that they can form their own locals into these areas. Thank you.
Thank you. They're good, two very good questions. On the first one, yes, the distinction between, in fact, there's a linguistic separation too. They're called workers versus expats. Expats are the professionals and technical people and managers and so on. And yes, there's a huge discrepancy. Now, the question is why? I think I tried to explain that in that it's an international labour market. There is no, I mean, they're trying to establish a minimum wage, for example, but it's very difficult to do that. There's no rational calculation of a minimum wage. And in fact, people in Qatar that I've spoken to simply want to go back to each of the origin countries, work out what is the living standard there, and then use that as a means to establish a minimum wage for that nationality, right? The cost of living there. And that's why you'll still get wage discrepancies. The principle of equal pay for equal work is being violated because of the international labour market. Some people think it's racism. It's not. It's because they're negotiating different wage rates, and that should be standardised. The distinction between professionals and workers, you tell me. I mean, the whole issue about the accommodation sites, which is where the visuals in the critiques of television and newspapers, because they get good visuals of work sites and you know, in the heat and so on, and the poorest accommodation sites, which are those who are bad, are very, very bad indeed. But they're now constructing huge new accommodation sites that are air-conditioned, that have lots and lots of amenities, making sure that they will have internet access and telephones, and that's happening right now. And in fact, one company that's about to start construction has the design from the architect that was in our team conforming precisely to the ethical standards of accommodation sites. That they're about to start construction now. So that's another story. So the issue about how do you attract people into the country that you want and that you need or that you feel you need, you bargain. You've got to work out how attractive would a wage be in order to bring those people over, right? And yes, if you want an architect or you want an accountant or a financial manager or all the various professions and engineers, you have to pay higher rates because you're more likely to bring them from the so-called first world, right? Because they're better trained. So then you've got to go to the cost of living in those countries and pay that. That's the international labour market at all these different levels, right? And that's why you get these discrepancies. Because if you want them to come, you have to make it attractive, right? Now, the Qatarization, Saudiization programs, just haven't worked, have they? I mean, it's correct in principle. You increase education and training for nationals so that they can fill the jobs that currently foreigners are filling. But what you find is that many of those jobs nationals simply won't do. The so-called 3Ds, which are the difficult, dangerous, and demeaning jobs, nationals just won't do them. They won't do domestic work. I mean, these countries now are totally dependent upon foreigners to do the work that they need to have done. It is a complete dependency. Who is going to clean those villas and houses, right? They're not going to do it themselves. So this is a catch-22 situation. On the one hand, yes, you want to improve and have more nationals and reduce the dependency on foreigners, but structurally that dependence is already there, and it'll only change a little bit because there are certain jobs that can't be done by or won't be done by nationals. Have I answered your question? Yes.
All right. Thank you very much for your presentations. And if you allow me, I'd like to build on both of them.
Sure.
I know that this is a big topic and it has a political and economic side, but I would like to come from within the HR human rights perspective. And I have two questions. My first question is, it's very nice to see all of these efforts ongoing, you know, to improve the situations of refugees or minorities, so on and so forth. But I think that this is all still tackling the surface of the problem. And unless we go down to the root of the problem, we will still sometimes get lost in details. We need to realign expectations. And expectations always go deep. So my question is, don't we have fundamental fallacies and inconsistencies in our definition of human rights? Because if we look at like the human rights, they were established after the World War in a specific context by certain member states for certain purposes. And since then, we have been making amendments or additions in order to adapt to certain situations, but do the definitions in the human rights text still hold today? And it's not only happening with minorities or in the case of refugees or in the case of Qatar or like international labor market, but if we also look at the world dynamics, it's changing also in the developed countries. It's like staying in one country for your entire life is becoming the exception. Rather than it being the norm. So in this light, do the definitions of citizenship and the definitions of slavery still hold? Because if we go back to the root and try to redefine them in the light of the new world order, we may be able to get rid of many of the labels that will solve the problem. Maybe even the label minority will not show up anymore. So I'd like to hear your opinion on that and whether there have been efforts in this regard or not. And my second question is very quick. In my opinion, what's going on in what we are calling international labor market is really slavery. And in the Islamic context, we know that slavery is mentioned in the Quran. Now, whether we would like to change the term to call it something else or not, I think we have a lot of principles and values related to this topic that we may dig into in order to solve this problem. So my question is, why don't we do that and be inspired by our source in order to solve a problem that has arisen contemporarily after so many decades? Thank you.
Thank you. Well, they're two very powerful questions. I must apologize with regard to the slavery issue. I actually gave you the wrong PowerPoint where I had developed another one where had inserted a lot of Islamic principles and also statements about slavery. Now, the issue, yes, it's being called slavery, but it's not really slavery. Yes, we know that slavery still exists in Mauritania, in Yemen, in Sudan. But other people are calling it slavery-like conditions because of the being bonded by the employer and the wages and the conditions of work. So there is still a debate about whether to call it slavery or not. I mean, slavery, the term slavery is being used politically, right, in order to highlight it, because it gets headlines in newspapers and so on, right? So it's very powerful to say this is a new form of slavery. And in fact, it was a book on this that actually got me first started doing my research on domestic workers by a guy called Kevin Bales, who wrote a book called Contract Slavery, to say that, yes, it's not chattel slavery, as in the past of ownership of the person, but it's control of the person. So it's like there's an old management, I don't know if you've read Berlin Means back in the 1950s, where they talked about corporations. It's a transfer from ownership to control of corporations, right? So it's the same kind of argument. So it's slavery-like. It's not real chattel slavery. Redefining the UN Human Rights Conventions and the terminology, I'm not sure that, I mean, yes, there have been adaptations, and I showed you earlier how they had adapted it to migrants, right, where it hadn't been specified that migrants need these rights too. That's an ongoing process. Language is fluid, and people come up with new forms of language, new term neologisms all the time to try to describe new situations or new methods and of articulating new theories. That's an ongoing process. But I think that one of the reasons why I presented you this was that I'm actually dealing with what's actually happening, not just theorizing about it and conceptualizing. We could do that. But also I'm concerned about the real live situations. I go out there, I talk to people, and I'm very much an activist in trying to bring about change. I'm very much engaged in Qatar with these reform processes and trying to push them. But also, we need to find out how they actually work, because it's complex. It's very, very complicated. There are different types of organizations who are not on the radar, right? I'd say that there are very few Qataris, nationals, who are involved in all of this. They're actually the foreigners who are exploiting their own nationals, both in the country of origin and in Qatar, because they're the ones who are running the companies. They're owned 51% by a Qatari, but they're not run. These are like passive, they're passive kafil, right? And very few of them are involved in the day-to-day process. They just take the money in a very passive way. So where do we locate blame for these violations? And I think it's important, what we're indeed trying to do is to show that these are anti-Islamic practices. Debt bondage, I mean, usury, I mean, it's absolutely against Islamic financial ethics, right? All of these things are absolutely un-Islamic. But it's happening, but it's not being articulated well enough in Islamic terms, and that's what we're trying to do, not just theorizing, but in practice, right? The more contact we have to bring about these changes. It's not just reform in principle, but actually changes on the ground. But it's difficult because there are a lot of vested interests. People who are receiving these bribes are going to be very resistant, and they are. I'm seeing it already, right? And it's not an easy process to bring about change. Well, the citizenship, if you want to do that, we will have to change the whole principle of state sovereignty. You try and do that. That's very difficult to do. Yes, we can talk about globalization. We can see that globalization in trade and finance have undermined borders. But when it comes to human beings, the opposite has occurred. Is the securitization of borders, the increasing restriction of borders to stop people coming in. At the very same time, the mobility of people has increased immensely, right? So we have these kinds of, it's not a contradiction, it's an irony in many ways, right, rather than a contradiction. So who is moving and for what reason? We need to distinguish these, right? Are they moving to find work? Are they moving for tourism, or are they moving for permanent migration? Are they moving because they're fleeing conflict and war and disasters of various kinds? All of these are different circumstances, and to put them all into one notion of migrants doesn't make sense to me. You need to distinguish the kind of migrants, which is what I tried to do in the earlier session. Another question.
Thanks for the presentation. So I'm here.
Sorry.
Yeah. I'm talking based on my 7 experience in Abu Dhabi. So I'm based in Abu Dhabi. I'm Algerian, working in Abu Dhabi, and just trying to explain all this labor issue. I think one of the most important things is we have to look at it is a number of. I'll give an example of Emirates because I'm based in Emirates, so I know what's happened there. So the number of Emiratis, for example, is barely 1 million, and you have another 4 million foreigners. Mm-hmm. So as you said, the country is run by foreigners. So there's 1 million person. I would say the infrastructure. Yeah. So it's mainly even the 1 million, they don't have skills. So I always compare them, like, for example, someone who has a very nice car, but he cannot drive. So he always needs a driver. It's not when the driver is sick, so he will not be able to move. So this is the metaphor that I want to explain. And this is why I think all this labor issue comes. Because to protect themselves, they have to make sure that those 4 million people, they will never have chance to have a citizenship. Because if they will start giving citizenship to skilled people, they will be, maybe politically, they will still, you know, administrations, you know, running the country is very important. So they can, so even if you are the president or the sheikh, whatever, so the people that they're running the country is very, very important. And we have seen this, for example, in Egypt. It's not only taking the power, being president is enough. So you have to make sure that all the infrastructure is following the same trend. So do you think that this is can be an explanation of all this very, very, I would say, labor issues? I mean, the fact that they want to protect themselves. This is why all this issue comes. So do you agree?
Of course they're protecting themselves. While they're faced with a situation, I mean, in the 1980s, for example, the vast majority of workers in the Gulf states were from other Arab countries. There was an Arab labor agreement to favor Arab workers in the Gulf states or throughout the Arab region. There are only two countries that really abided by that agreement, and that was Libya and Iraq. Because what happened in the Gulf states was that they began to see that because the Arabs coming in to do the work also brought their families. And they saw that in the future, it will be that they will begin to agitate for equal rights and citizenship. And they did not want that. There was mass expulsion of mainly Nasserite Egyptians, Palestinians, and Yemenis were expelled in large numbers. And then they replaced them with Asian workers, right? That they could better deal with, and there will be no compulsion to give them citizenship, and they won't agitate for citizenship or equal rights. Politically, in was the most important issue for them. Political control is absolutely crucial, and the whole issue of the kafala system, for example, also is a big issue for them. Actually, they in Qatar, yes, they've said they're going to do it. They said that it was going to be late 2014, then they said early 2015, and now it's going to be at the end of 2015, these reforms. But actually, I don't believe that they actually have the capacity to do it. The state does not have the capacity to handle all of the foreigners administratively. It's been relatively easy because it's been in the hands of individual citizens, right? So I don't quite know what to say. I mean, I was recently in Abu Dhabi, gave a lecture at New York University there. They've been under a lot of attack too because of the Sadayat construction process and the same situation of the workers there. And they are looking to make sure that how are they going to deal with this, right? These issues are ongoing. And how do you take control over all of these circumstances? It's very, very difficult. Because the policing, you can have all of the right principles and human rights principles and policies and mandatory standards that you like, but they have to be implemented. They have to be policed. And if you imagine all the hundreds of thousands of organizations and so on, it's not possible. The state does not have the capacity to do that. And so people will continue to get away with it until they're caught and until the prosecutions come. And whether they be based upon existing law or Sharia law, it doesn't matter. There has to be a process. And until that becomes serious, nothing's going to change. I was recently in Kathmandu and coming back to Qatar on the aeroplane. I wanted, you know, the standards have been in place for a while now, over a year. So I asked all the Nepalese workers on the aeroplane. Actually, I was rather naughty. I stood at the toilet waiting for them to come just to ask them, did you pay any recruitment fees? And everyone had. Every one of them had. So it's a long process. And I think that, yes, it's convincing the people to do the right thing, not because they'll be put in prison or fined, but to do it because it's the right thing to do. It's ethical principles, right? That's a hard process because there's always this tension between money and principles. Sometimes money, unfortunately, takes precedence. I think I've been told to stop. Thank you very much.
Any questions or comments or critical comments on my talk? So tell Dr. Ray arrive. Any questions, critical comments, contradictions? Just a moment. Oh, okay, it's here.
My question is related to methodology. When you quote hadiths and only hadith ahad or mutawatir, and I face this problem very often with my research, is that sometimes I have only the hadith and I don't have any verse dealing with a special subject. So how can I consider this? How can I build for my arguments and that the arguments can be strong enough, not having a verse dealing with this or particular points, but having only a hadith?
Do you have an example?
So I was working lately on masculinities and trying to get what was the ideal behavior for men, for Muslim men to have in Muslim society, especially in household with his wives and so on. And with these things, we don't have many verses. We have mainly hadith, and we have things from Sirah Nabawi, which implies how Rasulullah was dealing with his wives and how. And you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَكُلَّكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ إِسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ, which implies that normally men have to follow the example of Rasulullah with all matters of life, but also in this particular and very sensitive point, which is the relation between genders inside the family. So I would like to have some insights if you could help. Thank you.
More questions? Comments? Critical comments?
Well, maybe a critical comment from you on what Dr. Shankleti mentioned last time, that the hadith...
Feel free. If Dr. Shankleti with me, feel free.
What caught my attention, actually, his comment about reconsidering the corpus of hadith, because they were written like thousands of years ago. So what is your opinion? Because from the country...
The corpus of hadith?
Yeah.
In general?
Yeah, in general. To rewrite them, to make it more rigid, because from the country I'm coming, many people rely more on hadith, even if there is a clear statement in the Quran about the matter. And especially common Muslims, they operate on the level of hadith. For them, it is more important. So your comment on this thing.
I'm not going to hand a lecture. I know that everybody, they told me that I would not speak a lot. But my question is the same. Really the same, but is about the four schools. Don't you believe or think that there is a type of taqdis, how to say taqdis in English?
Sacred.
Say?
Sacred.
Sacred, yes, yeah, sacred. It's a kind of that the four schools, we look to them in a sacred way, that their interpretations in a way are not to be discussed, are not to be يعني قدسية المذاهب يعني قدسية المذاهب يعني في التقديس لكلام العلماء يعني لكلام المذاهب الأربعة وهذه من الإشكاليات الموجودة يعني. It's in the line of your question.
I told Dr. Ray that I expected that he will take 1 hour and a half, and I will take half an hour. And he said, "No, you will take the half an hour." I think he was right.
Assalamu alaikum. My question is for Dr. Ray, Dr. Ray, yes, Dr. Ray. I'm curious to hear your comments and your opinion about the ways in which the terms multiracialism and multiculturalism are used to define specific forms of minorities. I'm speaking specifically in the context of South Africa, whereas during apartheid, you had the society was there was a discourse of multiracialism. And so you had specific forms of religious identities that were racialized. So then you had, for example, I'm an Indian Muslim, but I was also formed part of a wider majority as non-white, either you are white or non-white. Whereas post-apartheid, you find that since the constitution, it's illegal, it's against the constitution to discriminate against your race, and your constitution guarantees your right to practice your religion and your culture. So since 1994, there's been this discourse of multiculturalism to describe the society. But what happens within that discourse of using multiculturalism is that now, in order to access your status as a minority gets narrower and of defining minority gets, over the 20 years has become narrower and narrower. For example, if you were in all government forms to access grants to enter universities, all application forms require you not only to put your race down, but as well as your religion or however, whatever cultural denomination you associate yourself with. So for so now you have Indian, Malay, and also and the new term is in Black African. So now we are everybody in the country is not African. Blacks are African, and you. You do, a few months ago, a few years ago, and that's intensified since a few months, we've had these attacks of xenophobic attacks, whereas the concept of a Black African has also narrowed down. When we talk about Black Africans, we're not meaning Zimbabweans or Nigerians or Somalis, because they classify as Black Africans, so we're meaning now Black South Africans. So your ability as a minority gets your position as a minority gets narrowed down in order for you to access rights. So I don't really have a question, but just how. What would be the utility of using, what would be a more appropriate concept to use if multiracialism doesn't, or multiculturalism doesn't work? What, in your opinion, would be a better frame of reference to describe the society or to categorize your identity within the society?
Thank you. Yeah, that's very, very interesting. In fact, I think you would have been classified as brown, as distinct from black or white, right?
And within a non-white.
Yes. I mean, and what's interesting now is that the term racism is not being used, but xenophobia, because of the discrimination, for example, against Zimbabweans and so on, so blacks with blacks. And, you know, the thing to do is to try to get rid of these classifications altogether, because they, they stigmatize, and they're based on very superficial characteristics. If we were to just treat, I know it's very idealistic, but if we were to just treat everybody as human and not have to feel the need to classify according to skin color or, religion or so-called ethnicity and so on. This is part of the problem, because these categories always establish the other. That is, it's a distinguishing characteristics from which people then discriminate. I mean, on the one hand, it's perfectly normal, I think, and reasonable for people to distinguish one another, because sometimes it's obvious. On the other hand, it's the way in which that's done, right, to set up power relations that are, I think, inappropriate. So a lot of these things are ways to put people down, to put them in at a lower status than oneself. It's been done since time immemorial. I mean, it's the idea of diversity, right?
But in South Africa specifically, they use the term either you're previously advantaged or disadvantaged as a justification for why they use these categories. But that's highly problematic, because how do you determine based on what, your religion, that you are disadvantaged, or only on your color? Because non-whites were discriminated differently. So
it's interesting, because always shocked me when I first joined an American institution at the American University of Beirut. And I was given a form to fill out, and it had the category of race. I couldn't believe it, because I thought that race, the very term race, in Europe anyway, it's banned. You can't, in the United Nations, you can't use this term, race. It's not. It used to be considered to be a scientific category, because, and this was the evolutionist argument about people. First of all, it was to do with animals and so on, and then it became transferred to human beings. That is, different human beings are at a different evolutionary scale from others, and usually it was the blacks who were on the bottom rung. In the United States, it's still used, and I was a bit shocked and got a bit angry, them asking me what race I was. And then I discovered that it's because they do it because they have a policy of affirmative action, right? So, in other words, there are quotas that they're required to actually employ or have a certain proportion of people employed who come from disadvantaged backgrounds. And that could be women, African-Americans, and so on and so forth. So we need to figure out, the thing is to figure out what it's all about. So it could be a positive thing. But often it's not in reality.
So I have four questions to answer.
Oh, sorry, I didn't know that.
No, it's okay. So the first question that was about Uswa. لقد كان لكم في رسول الله أسوة حسنة. The following of the Prophet, or the obedience of the Prophet. As I said in the first lecture, in my first lecture, in the first day, we have three terms in the Quran. which explained the three levels of the our relationship with the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. The first term that was, وَأَنِحْكُمْ بَيْنَهُمْ بِمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ. Judge between them by what God gave you. And the second term that, وَأَحْكُمْ بَيْنَهُمْ بِمَا أَرَاكَ اللَّهُ. What, by what God showed you. And the third term was, بِالْعَدْلِ, by justice. The ruling of the Prophet by justice. So I said in my first lecture that we have three levels of the rule of the Prophet. And not all of them are revelation. And this lead me to explain that, or to express a very important question that, which is all the prophetic reports revelation or not? In my opinion, and what I believe, not all the prophetic reports are revelation. Some of them, or some of the sunnah, not all of the hadith. Actually, I differentiate between sunnah and hadith. So let's say hadith here, the prophetic reports, not sunnah. So based on this, I have to say that we have to differentiate between the following the methodology of the prophet or following the prophet in every single deeds that he did. So this is what I understand from the sealing of a prophecy. Sealing of the prophecy means that the obligation that we have to do, or the duties that we have to do, is following the methodology of the Prophet, not every single deeds that he did, which is in the opposite side of the Salafi approach. So this is regarding to the first question. The second question was about Hadith al-Ahad. In the case that there's no Quran. We have a long discussion, a strong discussion in our history, in our tradition, that about the relationship between the Quran and Sunnah and Hadith. And the question, the most important question was, is everything in the Hadith, the prophetic reports, has mentioned in the Quran or not? So we had a very strong discussion in Usul al-Fiqh, in the principles of Islamic jurisprudence. So Shafi'i said, a sunnah or al-hadith, the prophetic reports, have three categories or three types of reports. The first one, the prophetic report explains that what the Quran said or mentioned. So the same, nothing, there's no added explanation or there's no added rule in the prophetic hadith. This is the first level, the first category. The second category is explaining, giving some details in the prophetic reports which was mentioned in general in the Quran, or which was generalized in the Quran. So, and the third category, which is the very important category that we have a very strong discussion and we have contradictory opinions about that, which is, Shafi'i said that the third category is to add, the Prophet can add something was not mentioned in the Quran. And the Prophet can independently new rulings, Islamic rulings. So, but there, not all of Muslim jurists agreed with this. So we have a very strong discussions, especially with the Hanafi school, especially with the Hanafi school, Hanafi madhab. So, and we had a long discussion about that. We have some tradition that explained in during the history, especially in the latest centuries, tried to explain that every prophetic reports has asl in the Quran. I mean, general rule or general principle or basis, reference. So we have some references explain that. So, but I think, as I said, we still have to work on this issue because it's very methodological issue and very basic issue. So, and I'm not going to tell my opinion here because I'm still working on the methodology on that. So, but my opinion clearly that not all the prophetic reports is revelation. Okay. The third question was about the function of the hadith or the purpose of the hadith. I think I did that. So. I would like to add something regarding to the second question. It depends on what are you looking for. So, based on what I said now, okay, are you looking for the opinion or the statement of the revelation or the statement of what happened in the history? So, revelation. So, that's important. That's very important. As I said, not all the prophetic reports are revelation. And then the second issue that it depends on the qualification of the one who is researching for. I didn't find in the Quran any indication for this issue, but you will find. Or some other body they will find. So it depends on the qualification of the researcher. So, and then I have to add one more thing here that we have to know. I think there's a silent space in the revelation. So we will not find every revelation for every single detail in our life. So there is masahat al-afu, the silent place or space. So we should, it's not supposed to find text for every single detail. So for regarding the last question, taqdis al-madahib. Okay. In 2000, I wrote my first article. I published my first article with Sha'ali Jum'a commented on me in 2000. It was entitled Nassul Faqih Tahawul al-Sulta, the text of the jurist, the transformation of the power. So I explained in that I was in 20 years. I explained at that time that what happened in the during the history, our history, and how the power or the authority transformed from the text of the Quran and Sunnah, from the revelation to the text of the jurist, and what's the mechanisms that were used to support this new authority during our history. And it was very critical and very deep at that time. And this is why Al Jum'a commented and wrote an article criticizing me at that time. And I wrote in again against him in 2001. So I think this is a very problematic issue. This is why I said in, the day before yesterday that when I was talking on the critical thinking, one of my goals when I'm talking about critical thinking to liberate yourself as a researcher, not as I'm talking methodologically here, so to liberate your human potential to liberate from the authority of jurists and the authority of the West, تحرر من سحر الفقهاء وسحر الغرب at the same time. So it's a matter of the taqlid, how the taqlid, the imitation, imitation, how the authority of the imitation formulated during the history. So it's a matter of authority of taqlid. It's not a matter of the authority of one jurist, you know, because you will find a lot of critical comments or discussion or debates in all traditions, in all juristic traditions. Each one of them will criticize another one, and he comment and he argued against or with. So there are critical thinking inside the juristic discourse. But I think the issue that the authority of taqlid, the system itself, how formulated, and then how what the functions that it played during the history, and why should we follow it or obey it now? So, and if we will not obey it, what we will do at the same time? So as I said again, when I was talking on critical thinking, the goal is not to destroy the system. I have to be very clear here. I'm not going to remove the authority of a Shafi'i to apply the authority of Mu'tazil Khatib or anybody else. No, keep a Shafi'i then. So I'm not, so if we are trying to remove authorities to put in other authorities, so we're not doing anything. We are forced from or forced by the same logic, but we have to follow methodology. Okay, I'm welcome to accept any contradictions, opinions, but by methodology. Tell me what's your methodology, and has it consistency or not? And is it valid to be applied on all issues that you are tackle or what or not? So this is the issue. Tell me your methodology, and you can go ahead, but you have to have methodology.
That's a scoop. No Mu'taz al-Hatib instead of a Shafi'i, mashallah. Look, I have a question about this, because, okay, so it will be the authority of a Shankiti. I have a question about this, because at the end, when we speak about the authority of a Shafi'i, or even the authority within the school, in Madahib, are we not talking about, at the end, behind the name, a methodology? Yes. There is a methodology. The fact is that behind every school of thought in Madhab, it's a methodology. So we are talking about names, but what we mean is a methodology. So what is new in the fact that you want to come with a new methodology, while it was always methodologies, even if we might change the name, not Mu'taz al-Khatib, and put a name for methodology, that will be the same, and what is new?
That's a very important question. So, not all the time or all our tradition, it was the authority of the methodology. Sometimes there is no methodology. Or sometimes it's not consistent, as I explained. But how it became or integrated to the system, to be a part of the system, how they made the consistency, the fake consistency, this is the issue. Because there was an authority over the authority of the methodology, or it covered by the authority of the methodology. So I agree, there was methodology in general, yes, but not all the time. It's not the case with all the time. Let's see what happened with Ibn Taymiyyah, for example, the last century. It's the authority of Ibn Taymiyyah, and even they didn't understand the methodology of Ibn Taymiyyah. But they have the authority, they're following the authority of Ibn Taymiyyah. And Ahmed ibn Hanbal and others. So, but if we understood the mechanism of, or the way that taqlid formulated during the history, yeah, we go deeply and discover the context and the system, how it formulated, we will understand that, we will find that there was methodology, and this is the system, what I'm talking about, and what I'm writing on. I believe that there was a system, and then if we didn't understand the system and how it formulated during the history, we are not able to change the system or to develop the system. But we have to understand that before, and the context of the history of formulation of this system and how it became an authority. And now why it's not valid anymore to be applied in current times. So that's it. Allahu A'lam.
This was my question. I just want to understand how normally to give authority to someone, even in modern research, in order to give authority to a certain researcher, people start to refer to him many times. Then after a certain time, he becomes a reference all over the world. And that's how authority is given to people. And that's how authority is given to those four madahab, because every time you speak, you say al-hasb al-madahab al-arba'a, or al-ijma' al-madahab al-arba'a, or When in this way that the people gave authority to those four madahab. And in this way, that's why I asked about taqdis al-madahab, and who is creating this kind of taqdis of, is it normal people, or is it people in the field who is creating this authority of taqdis?
No specific one, but it was a process, a historical process during the history. And then it was many groups worked on that, and then it became like it has roles and functions during the history, and this is why the people obeyed that. And then at the same time, we have to not avoid that there was authority, political authority, who applied these systems in the judgment, in the courts, in the political systems, and etc. So there is no one, just one, that okay, Shafi'i didn't decide that to put his to establish his school, and then told people that you have to follow me. He didn't do that. Okay, he expressed his opinion and his opinions, and he formulate his structure, and then the latest jurists based on him and develop his opinion, and they formulate the system century by century, and then it became what we call now taqlid. until there was a fatwa, a decree, an Islamic decree that you have to follow one of the fourth schools. And you are not allowed to follow anybody else. You have to follow one of the fourth. And then till the 19th century or the beginning of, the 19th century, when a new decree that, Islamic decree that founded that and said, okay, it's not valid anymore to provide us the functions or the roles that we need these times. And then we found a very early call for mixing between the madhahib, between the schools. It was from an Aleppo jurist who wrote a book about that in Halab, in Aleppo, in the 19th century. And he said that, and it was, at the same time, it was like a revolution. And then later, Qaradawi and others came to do the same thing, but it was Badreddin al-Na'sani in Aleppo at that time, and he wrote a book, and I have his book. So, and then later we founded another opinion that to go out of the taqlid and to go back to the opinions, to companions, to the followers, tabi'in, sahaba, and etc. So there is a process, there is a history. We have to understand the history and understand where should we go and where are we going, where we are going. So as I said, we have to understand the system, how it formulated, and then to transform from the system to another system, or to fill the gaps, or to shift the paradigm. I'm not trying to fill the gaps anyway, but some people like to do that. Okay, that's fine. Let them do that. But I have to change to shift the paradigm itself. And this is what I think. This is our job.
Very quickly, because I just want something to be clarified here. I'm trying to get the whole picture. So I will ask you a question, in fact, three questions in one go. When you are saying, I don't want to change a name, but at the end it's a question of methodology. So I have first, where lies the problem? Because at the same time, when we listen to you, when we are working in your field, which has to do with al-hadith, our sunnah, or distinguishing one from the other, do we have a problem of dealing with the sources? One. Second, do we have a problem with methodology? Because it's quite heavy to say sometimes there were no methodology. And if this is the case, I want you to give us an example. Where? In the Islamic tradition, when it comes to madhahib, or when it comes to the way we were dealing with the scriptural sources, you can say there was no methodology. When it comes to, even if the alim was not thinking of having a school, when you have something which is a school, it's based on, even though some of the followers did not get it, but there is something here. There is a system in Ibn Taymiyyah's approach to everything, I would say. There is something which is very powerful and sometimes not understood by the... So you said it, but my point is, how could you say that there was no methodology for some? If you have a historical example, it could be interesting. My third question, do we have a problem with methodology within history? So it means that within history, methodologies should change. And this is what we are saying, that shifting the paradigm is a new methodology is needed. Is this what you are saying? So my question, the source, the methodology, or methodology within history? Where lies the problem?
What do you mean within history?
Exactly what you said. You said we need to get the shape of the methodology within a specific period of time. So it means that the methodology has to do with time.
Yes.
So this is where the and maybe the last and the fourth and last question. التقليد, where lies the التقليد then? Are we مقلد, مقلد because we are following answers, or because we are repeating methodology?
It's a discussion between us. So you can leave something for the center, I mean. Okay.
Well, another way to look at this is if we look at it from perspective of history of religion, that there is something that we can call a religious cycle, that a religion started an abstract ideal, let's say spiritual or a humanistic ideal, and then this ideal is transformed into a concrete reality, institutions, laws, sometimes even empires. And then this institution that is born to serve the ideal, with time it gets outdated, exhausted, and then it becomes a burden on the ideal itself. So you create an institution to serve an ideal, but with time it became a burden on that ideal. And here you have to, then the circle is complete. You have to revive the initial spirit of the initial ideal. You have to go back to it or to revive it. Whether you have a new religion or some sort of revival and renewal of the original principle. This is Dawra Diniya, or the religious cycle. Islam is not an exception. This is happening, you know, all the reformation movement in all religion are just some kind of, let's have fresh start. Yes, let's have refreshing, let's refresh our computer. We need, where are we on this cycle today? That's my question. The second one is, how can we do it without losing the sense of time? Because I think there is a problem with the concept of time here. Some people will see this only going back to the first generation, going back, of course, and this is very common also in religious history. I mean, when Martin Luther was arguing against Catholicism or against the church, I mean, there is no Protestantism at the time anyway, but against the official church, he was saying, oh, no, this is the church, but not Jesus. I want to go back to Jesus. I want to go back to the founding fathers of the church. I want to go back to Peter, not to the Pope. So same today you have Salafis saying, no, I want to go back to Sahaba time, to Salaf Saleh. But the problem with Salaf Saleh, it's also a human experience. So not everything in that Salaf Saleh is Saleh. So how can we do this refreshing or fresh start without making ourselves enslaved by the historical image? Thanks.
What's wrong?
What went wrong?
Where's the problem? What went wrong? As Bernard will said. I think we have a complicated problem with references and with methodology together. And then I have to be clear here that we can't do paradigm shift without going or discussing or the resources, because there is no paradigm shift without going to the resource or the origins or and the history of the knowledge itself. And then, so there is no methodology without resources, and there is no resources without, you can't apply the resources without methodology. So we can't separate between them. They are together, they are integrated together, and they are the issue that is very complicated here. So how can you do paradigm shift without, from over all of you, if you are not going to the details and explaining the contradictions in the system, you're not going to do paradigm shift. And this is how the revolution, the science, scientific revolution happens.
Another card.
And, okay. And where's the second point that I have to mention here, so all, in my opinion, that all our problems, the modern problems with the Islamic tradition, comes in the modern times. Not because of the modern times. No, it's a part of the problem, because the modern times are very complicated, and they change the system. Or, as I said the day before yesterday, there are post-normal times. Post-normal times means that we are facing a very complicated situation that it wasn't existing during the history where our system was built. So now we need to shift the paradigm to adjust with the new system, to the new times. And this is what I called the day before yesterday, the spirit of the age. The spirit of the age. I said, like, we have five key concepts to think, to be critical Muslims these days. The first of the key concepts was the spirit of the age. And in this point, we can't build a methodology, transcendent methodology. It will be revelation at that time. There is no transcendent methodology, except the revelation. The revelation is the transcendent text and the transcendent methodology, which is the methodology of the prophets. Prophets, not prophet, one prophet. And the second key concept, which I mentioned too, the spirit of the religion. We have to understand the spirit of the religion. And we can't think critically without understanding the spirit of the religion itself. And the third key concept, it was the history. The logic of the history, we are in the history. We are a part of the history. And there's no any knowledge, any person, any imam, any school. It's a part. It's a part of the history. It didn't come from outside. It's a part of the history. So you can't avoid that, or you can't ignore that. So it's a historical knowledge. And the fourth key concept that I have to remind you, I said the critical reading of the tradition, because we will not restart our history. We will not restart our history from this point. We have a long history we have to deal with, and we are not, there's no qati'ah, there's no separation, strict separation between us and our history. We are the result of the history. We are one step of the developing history. We are, I don't know how I can explain that. Anyway, the fifth key concept, it was the scripture and the interpretation. And the interpretation related or connected with the spirit of the religion, the spirit of the age, and the history that we are living. Our spirit of the age will be later a part of the history. But it is the spirit of the age now. And this is why we had a lot of problems in the current times, or the modern, I like to call it a modern times, and this is what I'm working on, the jurisprudence in modern times, because I see that when the spirit of the age changed from the history to the current times, our jurists, Muslim jurists, didn't understand the logic of the tradition and the logic of the system that was built during the history, and the logic or the spirit of the age. And this is why they were confused. I explained that very well with many issues. For example, the issue that the apostasy, like today, and the fatwa in the during the Arab uprisings. I explained that, why they are confused, how they are confused, and why. So I think they are confused because of these issues, because of these reasons. So they're trying to apply to selective from the tradition, and sometimes to selective from the West, and and mix them together, and some of them is trying to avoid the West or the modern times and to reproduce the tradition in a modern way, as he think. So it's a very complicated problem, I think, and this is why I said we have to work on the five key concepts: the spirit of the religion, the spirit of the age, history, tradition, and critical reading of tradition, and scripture and interpretation.
Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Thank you, Dr. Mahtaz. I was not here from the beginning, so I missed maybe some points. But my question is, when we are talking about methodology and when we are talking about tradition, what are we talking about exactly? Are we talking about the methodology of al-fiqh, the methodology, so al-usul, the methodology of tafsir? Are we talking about aqidah? Are we talking about spirituality? So I think it's too broad, and I'm not able to follow what we are talking about exactly. Are we talking about al-fiqh, the jurisprudence? So I think if this is what you are talking about, the jurisprudence especially, and I think we have problems in all of these areas that I just mentioned. In all of the Islamic sciences, we have problems because of the history, like you said, and because of the fact that this science didn't reach a point where they were complete and didn't reach a point where they were able to address reality because the political, first of all, separation between political authority and religious authority, and then the reality was not addressed anymore, so the sciences become kind of abstract and kind of impotent and not giving fruits in the reality. But I think the main problem here is the main challenge is to develop the science and to restart where it stopped in order to enable the science to give their fruits in the reality, because a lot of parts are missing. But now my point here is about the methodology, if you are speaking about the methodology of al-fiqh precisely, because there are methodologies, there is no one methodology. So I don't know exactly what you're speaking about. So if you're speaking about the methodology of al-usul, is this what you mean? Usul fiqh? What is it? Okay, anyhow. So I just want to say that this methodology, I just want you to give me an example of about the methodological rule or something that is historical, so it is wrong because it was created in history. Methodology for me, the methodology of when looking at the methodology of approaching the text, either it is usul al-tafsir or usul al-hadith or usul al-fiqh, you see that this methodology is dealing with the nature of the text, is looking at the text as of this text has a certain nature, not only linguistic nature or rhetorical nature or morphological nature, but other kind of nature, how it's structured, how it's, for example, one of the natures of the text, the Quranic text, is that it's a text that is abstracted from the reality that it's talking about. It's talking about a reality, but with in a coming up with general things. That is why we never find a name in the Quran of a companion. A lot of texts in the Quran are talking about situations about the companions, but not coming with the details and with the names, because except of Zayd, but this is a special case because this is a special issue where the Prophet ﷺ was married to a woman that was the ex-woman of his son, adoptive son. So it's a special case and it's the only name.
So what's the point?
The point is that here, this is dealing with nature. For example, these rules are dealing with the nature of the text. The nature of the text, I'm giving an example. The example is here that the text is abstracted from the reality. This is something that was taken into account for developing methodology for tafsir and understanding the text. And this is the reality of methodology. So can you give me a methodological rule that is not dealing with the nature of the text in order to understand it, but it's historical and nothing to do with the nature of the text? Can you give me such an example of a methodological element that is historical and that is now problematic in producing knowledge? This is my first question.
The fifth question? The fifth
question? So I didn't get it well when you're speaking about religion as the spirit of the religion. Because at the end of the day, we may disagree about what is the spirit of the religion. Are you speaking about maqasid? Or what is it? What is the spirit of the religion? And at the end of the day, if we may disagree on the spirit of religion, we come to the same point. And also the spirit of the time. What is the spirit of the time and our era about? Ruh al-Asr, this is what you're speaking about. Of the age. Ruh al-Asr. So is my question here is, Ruh al-Asr, is it to be taken into account in order to understand the text, or because my understanding is that Islam came to challenge Ruh al-Asr and not to adapt to it. When we look at the attitude of the revelation towards the prehistorical society, the pre-Islamic society, I think it's considered the pre-Islamic society, but it came to challenge it, to challenge the paradigm of pre-Islamic society. So is this what you mean, or do you mean that the spirit of the time should be taken into account when reading the text and adapting the text or the understanding to the spirit of the time? I will just leave it here, inshallah. Shukran.
Thank you. I think I wasn't clear enough to explain that. When I'm talking about the methodology, first of all, I don't claim that I have completely methodology to change the world.
Oh.
So this is first of all. Second, I hope, I'm trying to do my best, but I don't have it yet. So the second, maybe I will decide later to be Hakim. Second, when I'm talking about the methodology, I'm not talking about the methodology of jurisprudence. And this is why one of the key concepts was the spirit of the religion. So the spirit of the religion, it doesn't mean that I'm talking about just jurisprudence. But at the same time, we have not avoided that jurisprudence is a basic element of the Islam. It's basic, but it's not the Islam. And this is the big mistake that we had during the history. It's a basic element, because how do you know halal from haram, the permissible and the impermissible, and which is a very basic in your myth, in your creed and your aqidah as a Muslim. So why you're dealing every day with halal and haram? So it's a basic concept, but now who decide which halal and haram? Is it just the jurist? This is the discussion. No, not just the jurist. But it's basic to know which halal and which haram. And this is what the Prophet, peace be upon him, said to Mu'adh, about Mu'adh ibn Abi Jabal. Al-halal ubayyin, al-haram ubayyin, and a'lamukum bil-halal wal-haram Mu'adh. Al-halal ubayyin, al-haram ubayyin, ubayyinahuma umurum mushtabihat. So it's the permissible very clear, is very clear, and the impermissible is very clear, and between halal and haram, there are some complicated situations. So it's very key concept, al-halal and haram, in our religion, in the Islam. But it's not the Islam. So we can't reduce the Islam to be halal and haram. So when I'm talking about the methodology, it's not jurisprudence, methodology of jurisprudence. But many of time, because we have a very complicated problem with the jurisprudence, I'm working on. But it doesn't mean that the methodology is just the methodology of jurisprudence. And then I would like to go back to a point that Dr. Tariq mentioned before. What's the problem with the taqlid? Is it a problem with the methodology, or it's problem with the answers? Both. And we can't separate between the methodology and the answers, because these answers were results from the methodology. So if we are looking for paradigm shift, we can't deal with the answers. We have to deal with the methodology itself, and rethink and questioning the methodologies that we had during the history and benefit from it. We have to respect our history. If we don't respect our history, our tradition, we will not develop or improve. But at the same time, respecting our tradition and our a'imma doesn't mean that we have to follow them or to not think or to obey them. So when I was talking about the history, I didn't say that every single details in the jurisprudence schools were a part of the history, but I'm thinking about the mind who established the methodology. Now you are a part of the history, and if we will analyze your methodology dealing with the issues and tackling this topic and not that topic, we will find the reasons, because you came from a specific context and you were thinking in a specific way and you taught from in a specific places and you got specific challenges, and then you moved from place to another, and etc. So, challenging, you are challenged from many in the context that you are living in, and the knowledge that you got, and in the question that you are facing in this world, you are part of the history. You can think out of the history. But it doesn't mean that every single information that you are tackling with or you are giving, it's a historical. No, I didn't say that. But at the same time, we have to understand the logic of the Quran. The Quran, actually, I didn't want to talk about that, but maybe I'm not saying. The Quran itself, the Quranic text itself, if we will rethink again about the naskh, I used to say that there is no naskh in the Quran. But maybe I was wrong. But at the same time, it doesn't mean that there are 1,000 verses, Quranic verses was abrogated. So, but at the same time, we can understand there was a developing in the Quranic text. Because, okay, that's it about the Quran. Yeah, as I talked about the slavery today, this morning, the slavery. We have, okay, because the history itself abrogated the slavery. So we have to deal with that because, although it's mentioned in the Quran, and we are worshipping the God by reciting these verses. But what about Hudud, for example? Why shouldn't be a part of the historical? I'm just asking now. I'm not saying it's a part of. I'm challenging. I'm challenging. I'm challenging. That's it. Okay. Okay. Forget about the Hudud. Other concepts. Who knows? We have to work on that. I'm not giving answers now. So we have to go deeply, and at the same time we have to keep our faith. We are mu'minun, we are believers. I'm not saying that, okay, let's go deal with the Quranic text and the revelation as Nasser Hamd Abu Said said. It's a linguistic text, so we have to deal with it as a linguist, because it came, the revelation became a text in a human language, so we have to deal with it as a human language. No, I'm not saying that. We are believers. So, I mean, what I guess, we are believers. So, and we have to deal with that. And at the same time, the spirit of the religion, it means the philosophy of the religion. The philosophy of the religion, it's not the Greece philosophy. And it's not the Western philosophy at the same time. It's like my teacher, Taha Abdul Rahman, wrote a very, very important book in Arabic. He called it The Spirit of the Religion, and I agree with him. And it's a very important book in the philosophy of religion. As I said the day before yesterday, he's talking about the tashheed to the action of witnessing, the action of witnessing, not to be shahid, no, to do witnessing, to marry a tashheed. And what does that mean, witnessing? To combine between the unseen word, al-ghayb wa-shahada, so, and to apply the values of the ghayb, the unseen, our metaphysic, in the seen world, in the physic. So, at the same time. So, this is what, because we are ibadullah, and this is what ibadah mean, worshipping. It's not just praying and fasting and go to the mosque. So, this is the spirit of the religion. And to understand the logic of the religion. The logic of the religion means the same that when I'm talking about the logic of the jurisprudence. So, and the ruh al-asr, the spirit of the age, it doesn't mean that we have to adapt with what's coming from the West or for what's coming from our dictatorship regimes. So I'm not saying that we have to adapt with our reality. Of course, our reality has a lot of troubles and problems and complicated. And so I'm not saying that we have to follow and adapt as Sheikh Qaradawi does, or his life, or other jurists. But at the same time, I respect them, of course, but I criticize them. And this is, when I criticize them, I feel like I'm closer to God than obeying them or following them. So the spirit of the religion, the age, it means that the shift of the paradigm of the age. And it doesn't mean that you have to adapt. I'm not saying that. It's a philosophical concept. I'm talking alone here.
I'm enjoying it.
So, we forgot that we are two.
There is a question. Yeah.
Okay.
May I ask?
First question that you come from you to me. Yeah.
Well, I'm glad because I don't feel as not intelligent now, given that two of our scholars are equally confused, it seems, and asking you a similar question, I think. What methodology did you apply to come to your five concepts? And are these five concepts the basis or the outline of the new paradigm shift that you want to move towards? Because you're saying we need a paradigm shift, and I think that was the question that Professor Tariq was asking, is in what is the problem that you're trying to solve by saying we need it? And do you think there are still parts of the Taqleed legacy which are still necessary today? Or are you about, is this a colonizing project, get to know that arena very well, but then subvert it from within? And of course, I'm putting it in the most extreme way, I suppose. And are you coming from a position that you've already concluded something that it needs to be adjusted towards? And what does that look like? So I'm kind of asking about where are you going to? And is that vision based on, and what basis is that based on? And how would you articulate the filter with which you are examining the history and the methodology and the source? Does that make sense? Okay.
Answering is very easy. Again, I don't claim that I have the full answer, the full and last answer. I'm still improving and developing my knowledge and my methodology. It's not ready. So, but I know, what's for. That's important. It's for the goal is to leave, to keep your faith, and at the same time you to live in your age, not in the history, not in the past, and not in the times, the Western times. West is not the whole world. It's a part of the world. Okay, this is what I'm saying, because I'm in the East. I'm not in the West. But if you are in the East, okay, you are part of the East. But the West is a part of the world. Yes. Okay, it's not the world. And at the same time, we are in the East. We are not just the world. The center of the world, yeah. Huh? So I'm. Yes, the world, not the Western universal, as we're talking about. So. Okay. Yes. And of course, I'm not talking about homosexual. It's not a part of the spirit of the age. I gave you a part of an answer to a part of your questions. But I said, yeah, okay, for the five key concepts. Yeah, I answered on the goal. So, and then regarding to the five key concepts, what's the methodology? Because I think that the five key concepts can help us to build the comprehensive view, and we can't live without the spirit of the religion, and the five key concepts it's contain or constitute the our age and our religion, and so it's comprehensive with the basic elements that we have to deal with. So the first criteria that why I chose these five concepts is the comprehensive, and the second one is because it depends on the explanation of the problems that we are facing during the current times, and then I think it contains the whole. I have a problem with explanation in English, so it contains the problematic issues that we are facing in these times. So I think it can help us to resolve the or to build the new methodology and paradigm shift that I am looking for. I don't know if anybody else looking for.
Well, do you need a break? Okay. So my question is, what inconsistencies are you seeing today that struck you as being so important that we need a whole new methodology to look at the religion? What are you seeing today? Are you seeing believers doing crazy things even though they're trying to be faithful? Are you, like, what was the thing that you saw that you just thought, this has to change, and I'm going to start trying to change the whole methodology because there's no other way to fix it?
As I said the day before yesterday, changing or thinking thoughts is not coming from your mind when you are isolated from the community and from the knowledge and from... So I have been working on this field for 20 years. So it developed during this history, my history, and during the my knowledge and my problems that I faced with the field and with the scholars and with shiuch and with, you know, with the current times. And so it's a part of the historical developing. So it's not just, okay, I looked at the word and then, okay, that's not good, so we have to change. It's not like that, yeah. So, but
could you give us a few examples of the inconsistencies you saw? Because right now, this is all very theoretical.
I gave a very good example in this lecture today, this morning, about the apostasy, okay. For example.
That's...
Yes.
Are there more?
And I gave in my first lecture about the boundaries of the prophetic functions.
It's kind of a halfway, is about slavery, actually. Maybe it's the point you were going to make, that you're saying something about Islam, like, now you could say, extract that it doesn't allow slavery, but I would say that you could say that actually slavery will always exist and kind of still does today, and that Islam provides for that, and so rather than kind of saying that the transformation of that period makes it seem like it's not allowed now, I would say it's accommodating for that now. I don't know if you could comment on that. I don't know if that was the point you were going to make, but.
You're going to ask Dr. Ray.
I mean, he can comment on it too, but I don't know about.
Yeah, if what you're suggesting is that within the Quran, there's plenty of evidence suggesting that slavery was not really a good thing. All of the mentions of the means for manumission of slavery, the treatment of slaves was a way to say that, you know, things need to be much dealt with much better, although at the same time accepting the existence of slavery. But some people have said that it's actually, it is a text for the abolition of slavery, if you take all of those things combined. But with the recognition that that was not possible because it was so entrenched. So there's a double element there. But we do need to acknowledge how much of an anti-slavery text it is, while acknowledging that it is there, and there are rights over slaves. But that's the same situation in any hierarchical cultural system, which is everywhere. We will never escape hierarchy, unfortunately. But that's always an issue.
Sorry, it gives, it like allows in that way, it almost kind of presumes that slavery will be a constant throughout, like it is today still, and it gives rights for that. So that's not kind of in the black market, and it's not undercover that we have slaves maybe in that sense, but that they have their rights and they're not cheated and as such, because the hierarchy will always exist. Yeah.
Well, the difference is the issue of ownership, but it has been likened, the contract of ownership of slaves has been likened to the contract of marriage, right? That it's the same kind of thing, ownership over the body, which I, you know, obviously the feminist movement have argued very much against that, but acknowledging and analyzing that to see what it actually meant. And that's why often women refer to marriage as slavery, right? Ownership of the genital organs. So, yeah, we can have another debate about that another time. Oh.
Is it too late to ask one question of Ray? I'm just curious as to know, on the one hand, we say when it comes to women's issues, when it comes to things like alcohol, where it was very, very entrenched, and the most entrenched cultural and religious practice was idolatry. And yet there was no hesitation in saying we are having a paradigm shift, you know, on every level, you know, the tawhid paradigm shift. But then when it comes to slavery, we're saying, well, that was too much to tackle. And that's the thing I just don't get. You know, how do you explain the kind of things that are not said as well as the things that are said? Because it would have been very easy to say slavery, you know, it's now time to abolish it. In the same way when people were condemned for burying their daughters alive, you know, we had all sorts of what we would consider very unjust practices. So I completely get that, you know, the spirit of the Quran and the ethical paradigm would mean that that's our conclusion. But to say that simply because human beings in history made it redundant, But actually we still can justify it, shouldn't it be something that we should be totally be opposed to if we believe in this kind of equality? So that would be my question, is in what thoughts would you have on that?
Another time.